coming up next in your dream.
Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for tuning in. You're listening to In Your Dreams, and I'm your host, God's Girl. You know what? We've got two great callers, and they both just happen to be from Chesapeake, Virginia. Our first caller today is Tom. In his dream, he's got four tornadoes hot and heavy on his trail. And then our last caller today is Chayla. She had a dream that she had a pig in her wheat field. Stay tuned. It's dream time. Welcome to In Your Dreams, Tom. How you doing today?
I'm doing okay. How are you?
I'm good. Where are you calling from?
I'm calling from Chesapeake.
Virginia?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so tell me your dream.
In my dream, I was riding in my car, and I was like on some kind of highway, mm-hmm. kind of like a interstate, like, you know, how they have the ramps and all that stuff. And
so you were on an interstate expressway?
Uh-huh.
Okay. Were you in your car?
I was in my car.
The one that you drive now?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
And in the dream, I noticed that there was a storm coming.
Mm-hmm.
It was windy, and the sky was getting dark. It was sometime around dusk.
Mm-hmm.
And I saw one of those little, you know, the little telephone things they have on the side of the road sometimes for emergencies.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That nobody ever uses.
Yeah, that no one ever uses. And it's kind of weird because, I mean, I have a cell phone and stuff, but
right.
in the dream, I kind of stopped.
Right.
And I stopped in one of those, and it seemed that I was in a rush, and I called my mother.
Mm-hmm.
And I told my mother, I was like, there's a storm coming.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like I was telling her so she can get ready, so she can prepare, do whatever she needed to do to weather the storm.
And that is a good sign.
Cool.
Yeah.
So then in the dream, I hop back in my car, and it's like I'm in a rush on the interstate, and then it seems like it jump sequence or something, and then I'm like driving into, I'm trying to get out of the storm, and I look around and I see like four tornadoes.
Mm-hmm.
And where I'm at now, it looks like is like I drove out of like the city area, and it's in the country.
Mm-hmm.
And it's flat all around, and it's night now. Now it's dark.
Okay.
And I'm driving to get out of it, and I see four, and they're spinning real fast, and I know, I was like, man.
Are they in front of you? Are they behind you? Are they all
they
around?
They were. It's like they were behind me, and they were all together, lined up.
Okay.
So I drive to get out of them, and I see like a barn,
mm-hmm.
a big shed, you know, something that they would have out in the country.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like I see that, and it looks like it's the only place of shelter, pretty
mm-hmm.
much.
Mm-hmm.
So I drive into it, and somehow it's a lady that I'm dating, and her daughter, like, they're there.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm running in, and they're up at the top of level of the barn, and I'm at the near the bottom level of the barn.
Mm.
And there's like a ladder, and I'm telling them, I'm like, there's a storm coming. Y'all need to come down here. It's like it's not safe up there.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know, for some reason it looked like they were kind of scared or something.
Mm-hmm.
And they were staying up there, and they weren't coming. So then I was like, well, I started praying for protection.
Mm.
And I was like, Lord, please protect us and hide us, keep us safe.
Mm-hmm.
Because the thing about these tornadoes is that in each tornado, there was a person inside of these tornadoes. They weren't natural tornadoes.
Okay.
And I realized that they were bad.
Now, when did you discover in the dream that there was a person in the tornado?
When I was driving away from them,
mm-hmm.
I kind of noticed that there was like a person in the, like these dark figures inside of the tornado.
Mm-hmm.
It was like the shape of a person.
Okay. And that was the end of the dream?
No, that wasn't the end of the dream. So
there's more.
I was,
wow.
So
who needs to watch TV?
I was praying, and I was asking God to protect us and stuff like that. So
mm-hmm.
two of the tornadoes, they went off, and they just kept going. I could feel like their purpose was to destroy things. Like, they were just going after things that they could tear up. Two of the tornadoes stuck together, and they came towards the barn.
Mm-hmm.
And they came into the barn, and they became people when they got inside of the barn.
Were they male people or female people?
No, one was a male, one was a female.
Okay.
And it's like they were looking around, but they didn't see us.
Mm-hmm.
And I was down on the lower level because, you know, I went down there, I was trying to, you know, get out of the storm and stuff, you know, to go into a bunker or something. Mm-hmm. And they were up there, and I asked God to protect us all, and we were protected. They didn't see us at all.
Mm-hmm.
And then they jumped out, and they turned back into tornadoes, and they kept going around tearing stuff up.
Okay.
Then I woke up.
All right, so that was the end of the dream.
That was the end of the dream.
Okay, good, good. All right, well, that sounds exciting. And overall, it sounds victorious, doesn't it?
It does.
Because nobody was hurt by the tornadoes.
No one was hurt. No.
And you said two of them left, right?
Mm-hmm. Two of them went spinning off in their own area anyway. And the two that came, you know, to get me or us.
Inside the barn?
They came inside and mm-hmm. they didn't see us.
Okay. All right. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to come into real life. And we're going to talk about the dream. And in this dream, how did you feel, or did you have any thoughts that were prominent in the dream?
My thoughts in the dream, I felt like nervous, and I felt like I need to get out of this storm. This is bad.
Okay. But you also said earlier you felt like you were in a rush.
Yeah. Like okay. I was in a rush. Yeah.
Okay. So what happened in your life, or what's going on in your life that the last thing you kind of felt in a rush about and kind of nervous about? Maybe you're in a hurry.
Not too much, really. Not that I can think of.
It could be anything. I don't want to tell you because I want your answer, and you might have to think a little bit. It might be something that not seems really significant to you, but could be significant for the dream. Hypothetically, if I was in a rush to go to the grocery store yesterday, I might not think that's a big deal.
Yeah.
But I was still in a rush to get to the grocery store. So there's somewhere that you're in a rush. You're trying to get from one place to another. You're trying to get out of the way. You're on the expressway. So you're in a hurry. You're in the fast lane. Because we take the expressway when we're, traveling from city to city.
City to city, yeah.
You know, we're not just going around our neighborhood. So you said you were in a rush and you're trying to get out of the way.
Like I knew I needed to get out of the storm.
Okay. So is there any type of personal storm going on in your life? Are you in school? Are you personal storm at church? Relationships?
Maybe relationships.
Okay.
I've had, transition. Like, it's been a while since I've just been dating one person.
Okay. So, you have women chasing after you?
Duh.
Do you?
A little bit.
Okay, because two of these storms were people. One was a male, and one was a female. So, the storms in the dream have identified themselves to be of a personal figure. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
They've revealed themselves. Two are at back and not really in intimate danger to you. But one is a male and a female. He said they weren't good. It could represent a married couple. It could be an old friend that you had, maybe that you don't want to hang around with anymore. It could be a female that used to like you and you just don't think that she's good for you. But you're in a rush in the dream. You want to get away, and you can foresee it in the dream. It's hot on your tail. So what was the last thing you were a little bit nervous about, if it was relationship-wise or in a rush about?
Well, with her, it was about rushing it. Don't want to rush anything.
You don't want to rush anything?
Nope.
Okay. Now, who's her? You don't have to give her the real name. Is this an old friend? Because the lady you're dating now, you said, I don't know who she is, but you said she's in the barn with her daughter, right?
Yes.
Okay. So you end up coming face to face with her
mm-hmm.
in the dream.
Mm-hmm.
Well, is there anybody in your past? Because the beginning of the dream could start you off in the past. Was there anything that you left behind? You left one city, came to another city?
I've moved.
People that may have not been good for you?
I left Hampton not too long ago.
Okay.
Before I moved up into the Virginia area, I was in a rush to move. I did want to move.
Okay, so tell me before you moved in. See, because the dream could be taking you back further, the beginning part. You understand what I'm saying?
I do understand.
Okay, so where were you at when you were in a rush to get out and to get to Virginia? What state were you in?
I was in North Carolina.
Okay, so you lived. See, I don't know much about you. You lived in North Carolina. And then at that time, you were in a rush to get to Virginia.
I was happy to leave.
Were you a little bit nervous, like the dream?
I was.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So see, those two feelings fit. Okay. We're not making them up. You said, yes, I was in a hurry. I was in a rush to get here. And I was a little bit nervous. Now, why were you a little bit nervous?
Well, because I hadn't lived up this way in a long time. And I knew I was leaving some things in North Carolina, like I had a job. And I was close to some family and friends.
Okay. So were there any family or friends, I guess, maybe brought drama in your life that would, you know, you said the storms, two of them, you said you knew, well, you knew they were all bad.
Yeah, I knew they were all bad.
And we know, because you told us, that two of the storms were people.
Uh-huh.
So whether it be two people, a man and a woman, that may turn people's lives upside down. Tornadoes are what?
Tornadoes are storms.
They're destructive, right?
They suck up things and tear stuff up.
And they're house wreckers, aren't they?
Uh-huh.
Home wreckers.
They are.
You know, so is there anything like that that you could put in a package of people that you knew in your past in North Carolina?
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Now, who are those people?
Well, there's a couple, like I used to hang out with and stuff. And
a male and a female couple?
Yeah.
Okay. So, do you see how they could be the two storms?
I do see that.
Okay. So, the couple, why did you stop hanging out with them? Or why do you see them as people that suck up things, or why are they being symbolic, being a tornado?
Because anything that's in their path, they suck up and turn into bad.
yeah. Is that by their morals or their bad values, or is it by, are they moochers, or?
All of it.
All of it. Okay. Praise God. So your dream is showing you kind of like cartoonish pictures. The dream is giving you pictures in your heart, a vision picture of what these people symbolize to you.
Wow.
Isn't that amazing?
That is amazing.
So, in the dream, okay, this couple, and there's two other storms, but the dream doesn't reveal that they turned into people, but these tornadoes, they didn't follow you all the way into the barn, okay?
Mm-mm.
They were kind of just on the outskirts. So, are there two other particular individuals that you could think of that you left behind? The dream shows that they followed you on the highway. Which could just mean that even though you're in Virginia now, you know, they're hitting you up on the phone.
Yeah.
You know, or they're hot on your trail, meaning that, you know, it's kind of hard for you to get away from them, even though you've decided to leave. But do you see, does any of that fit?
Well, I saw them like on the horizon, but it looked like they went their own ways, like they went different ways, but the other two, like they followed me into the
barn.
Uh-huh.
Now let's find out what a barn means to you. So we always want to go to our heart for the answers. Book is the last priority, but have you ever been in a barn? Do you have any impressions of what a barn is? Just like you answered the question about the tornado, what do you think about a barn?
Whenever I see a barn, I think of, like, in movies, animals always live in, and there's always hay and stuff like that. And it's like it's protection from, whenever I see them, too, well, always running into them to get out of a storm or something.
So protection. This barn that you drove in, the one you drove into, you said the mother and the daughter were up on a higher level.
Uh-huh.
And you were on the lower level, and you were trying to protect them. So is there any way, shape, or form that you're trying to help this woman that you're dating now, or keep her away from the people that are in your past, from, you know, getting together and maybe hanging out or going to dinner, or I don't know, or the people in your past, the couple trying to invite themselves up here? You're praying for shelter in the dream. You're praying for to protect all of you.
Mm-hmm.
So if we're talking about your past and these people that are like a tornado, and we're talking about where you found cover at, where have you think you found cover from these people?
As of now?
Uh-huh. When I think of a barn, I think of country.
I think of country, too.
Country.
That's what I think of, too, the country.
But Virginia ain't too country, is it?
It's not.
It's a big city, the part that we're in.
I was driving out of here, though.
You were driving out of North Carolina. Mm-hmm. This dream is symbolic of the time when you were in North Carolina and on your way
here
to Virginia. Mm-hmm.
My mom lives here.
And your mom doesn't live in a barn, does she?
No, my mom doesn't live.
Does the lady that you're dating, does she have anything country about her? Or is she rural or is she poor?
She's not.
No?
No.
Because she's in the barn. When I think of barn, too, I think of storage, a place where you can store things.
Mm-hmm.
But you said shelter. So have you ever seen this barn in real life?
No,
so
the closest thing I can think of is like Smallville, like when Clark and his family have one. That's what it made me think of.
Okay.
What it looked like.
All right, Smallville. So you pull over into a barn in Smallville. See, symbols are very personal to the dreamer. You have to poke around a little bit before you can find out exactly what things mean. But regardless of what it means, you're praying. And you can just chew on that later and say, okay, Lord, why did I pull into a barn, you know?
Because so, it looked like it was the only thing around.
Right.
Yeah.
So in real life, where did you find shelter at from these people? Maybe that's a better question.
Probably church. Church and my relationship with God and my mom.
All right. So how would we associate a barn with church? New Life kind of looks like a barn, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Like a long barn. Did you meet this lady at New Life?
She goes there.
Okay, all right. So let's just go with this since we don't have a better answer, right?
Mm-hmm.
New Life, we'll just call New Life the barn, the place where you found shelter with God and in your relationship. Now, is this woman on another level than you spiritually?
Kind of. Well.
In the dream, she's on the top level. She's up in the loft, and you're on the lower level.
Uh-huh.
Top level would usually speak of a higher place. You know what I'm saying?
Uh-huh.
But you're trying to get her to come down because you want to help her. Is there anywhere she's on a higher level than you, age-wise, education-wise, maturity-wise?
Probably,
You're laughing.
In her job, she has a higher position than I have.
Okay. So is that financially you think she's on a higher level?
Maybe. Yeah.
Or just in her intellectualism as far as the type of job she has?
The type of job she has, probably.
Okay. All right. Is that a type of barrier for you guys at all?
A little bit.
Because you in the dream, thank you, Holy Spirit, you in the dream, you want her to come down to your level.
Uh-huh.
But she doesn't want to come down.
No, she didn't.
So if we go with this is where the dream ends, and, you know, you're praying, it means, you know, you're considering her in your prayers, you're asking for protection, you're asking for safety, you're asking for shelter. You know, you don't want your past life to affect anything with your relationship with her. Is that correct?
That's true.
Not that you were doing anything wrong. You know, these people, if they're sucking up things, that's them.
Yeah.
So we can just pray for them. But
mm-hmm.
So you're okay with the dream from the beginning to the end except for the barn?
Yeah.
Okay.
Uh-huh.
So you can see it.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, good. All right. So if she's on a higher level in a loft with her daughter, and you're saying your answer in real life is probably in her job.
Uh-huh.
What about her job makes you and her not be able to meet?
Oh.
Because in the dream, you weren't together under the same building, but she wasn't coming down and you weren't going up.
Probably because she's my boss.
Okay. All right. Thank you for not lying.
Okay. I was trying to go there.
Do you see how the dream can show stuff? And if you wouldn't have said that, I would have looked stupid.
Okay.
but you told the truth. Okay. So she's your boss, and we're not mentioning any names here. So with this lady, she doesn't want to come down. She's your boss. Okay. So now we got to talk about what the word says in real life or find out what we can do, because the dream can show us a picture, but we always want to go to the word to find out what we should do if you're bewildered about it.
Okay.
You understand?
I do.
Okay. So you like her?
I do.
You love her?
I think I may.
Okay. Now, what's her feelings towards you?
The same.
So the hindrance is that she doesn't want people to know, or she's not willing to risk her job, or what is it?
Yeah, pretty much. That on both sides.
Okay. All right. So pretty much you got this relationship, but you're stuck.
Yes, ma'am.
So what do you think you should do? What are your options?
Go somewhere else, or go somewhere else.
Okay. And so had you considered that?
I have considered it.
Do you think that she's the one that the Lord has for you?
Still trying to figure that out. I think she may be.
All right. And it's kind of hard. But are you both on the mentality of marriage?
I'm getting there. I hadn't considered it before.
Okay. Well, the reason why I ask that is because if you're both in the mentality of getting married, okay, in other words, if she's just in the mindset, I'm just dating, you know what I mean? I don't want to get married until my daughter's raised, or she may even run it, may never know she wants to marry until you ask her. You know why?
Why?
Because women don't want you to know how they feel, because if they let you know how they feel beforehand, then you think you got a sure thing. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Because the Bible tells us to guard our hearts, for out of it flow the issues of life. So when I met my husband, he had to lay his heart on the line. He had to tell me before I ever gave him an answer. Until then, I was playing it cool, and he didn't have a clue. So she may never, ever tell you until you lay your cards on the table. So relationship-wise, and the way that women think, because a lot of times when you tell a man that you want to marry him, or you start talking like that, they clam up or run the other way. And doesn't every guy really like a chase?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. So this is what I think you can do from a female perspective, okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Just keep seeing her while, you know, you're at your job or whatever. But when you think that you know, and you think that the Lord lets you know that she's the one for you, then if it takes quitting your job, I wouldn't quit my job. I would tell this person. I would say, so-and-so, whoever her name is, this is the way I feel. I believe that you're supposed to be with me for the long run. Whatever. Do your thing. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And then get an answer from her.
Okay.
If she says yeah, then leave your job and go find another place. If she doesn't say yeah, keep your job, and I would break it off. Because, you know, how can two walk together unless they're agreed?
Well, she already told me that she believes she's the woman for me.
Really? So you got a sure thing, just about.
I guess that she told me that, and she told me that before I even really knew her really well.
Really?
It kind of freaked me out a bit, to be honest.
So when did you discover that you believe that things are going that way?
Well, because I have dreams about her. And I think about her, and sometimes I don't even think I like her.
Sometimes you don't even think you like her?
Sometimes.
Why?
Because there's things about her that I don't like. But she's a sweet person, and I see her moving places in the Lord, like places she wants to go and stuff. It seems mostly that I've been a stronger Christian than her. And the thing about her being on the top level in the barn made me think, well, like when you said that, I was thinking maybe it's her position over me at work. But then when you said that, I was thinking, well, I was praying for her protection and stuff, and I wanted her to come down, not like to come down to my level, but I wanted her to be safe. I knew the storm was coming. When tornadoes come, it seems like the best place to be is somewhere low where you can hide and be out of them.
Does she have any bad influences in her life?
I think she has a friend that is not saved.
Okay. So regardless, you have a heart to protect her, and you have a heart to shelter her. But just because you have a heart to protect somebody and a heart to shelter somebody doesn't mean that you're called to marry them.
Yes.
So you're really just going to have to seek the Lord, because if you continue to see her and she falls in love with you even more, then God's going to hold you accountable for her heart to a certain degree. You see what I'm saying? Because you're leading her on by being a nice guy.
Wow.
Because all the girls want a nice guy. But if you said to her, look, I want to be your Christian brother. I care about you as a person, but I don't see myself being with you romantically for the long haul, because there are sometimes I don't even like you, you know? And you should, you know, step back.
How ugly does that sound?
Well, it's the truth. And that's why it's important not to jump ahead and to really just be friends with somebody. And I don't think it's appropriate for a woman to be chasing a man anyway. So I don't think it's appropriate for a woman to address her feelings for you unless she's under the impression that you have the same feelings for her. So if you've led her on in any way, shape, or form, and you don't have the intentions of being any more than a friend, then you should probably ask her to forgive you. You know what I mean? And try to discern the relationship. Is this somebody that I just want for a friend? Is this someone that's even a candidate to be my wife scripturally? But husbands are always called to be the leaders of the home. And so the husband should always be the spiritual leader. So it's right for you to be spiritually ahead of her, in a sense. You see what I'm saying?
Yes.
So that's okay. But it's not okay for you to date her or to lead her on if you don't have any intentions of taking it further. And you don't want to take it further just because she's sweet.
No, she's sweet and she's nice. And it just sounds not good. I mean, I see potential in her.
Right. But you don't want to marry somebody for who they could be. You want to marry somebody for who they are. Because you have to ask yourself, if this person never, ever changed, never, could I live with them and love them the way that they are? You see what I'm saying?
I do.
So, and they'll tell you that in some counseling sessions. If they never changed, can you enjoy this marriage? So, you got a lot to think about.
Okay. Wow.
So you got it squared away?
Got it squared away. Thank you.
Squared away is you can't, you don't want to marry her for who she could be, right?
That's right.
You want to marry her for who she is.
She's a wonderful person now. She is.
Well,
she's working towards goals and stuff, and I am too.
Yeah, but a few minutes ago it sounded like you didn't like her that much.
No, it's just sometimes she makes me very angry. I've never dated someone that made me angry before.
Really?
Really.
Well, you know, there are times when my husband makes me angry, and I never got angry before, much at all. And I had to pray about it. I said, Lord, you know, I said, he sometimes makes me really angry. Don't get me wrong, we have a great relationship. But what it does is it shows me a side of me that I didn't know that I had before. So a lot of times we're not angry because we're not in the right circumstance. So God wants us to be able to be Christ-like in any circumstance. So sometimes he'll allow things to happen so we can deal with our anger. But you just have to decide, is this a person I want to be just a friend, or is this someone I want to be more than a friend and possibly marry? And then when you decide that, then you can decide which way you're going to go. And if you decide to go further with her, you know, you should be honest and say, look, you know, I had some decisions to make, you know, about who we are and where we're going. And I feel like maybe we can go further, but I can't make you any promises because the Lord at any time could tell you she's not the one. You see what I'm saying?
Yes.
So you always want to give room and let her know that you're giving room for the Holy Spirit to make the calls in your life. But once you commit, you're committed.
Okay.
And there's no getting out. But
okay.
I would keep my job until you decide. If you decide she's just going to be a friend, then stick to your decision, because every decision you make is going to be tested. So if you decide she's going to be just a friend, keep your job and then walk in like manner. But if you decide she's going to be more, then you might want to consider asking her to marry you, or saying we can go further until the Lord, you know, lets me know for sure. But you should probably switch jobs then.
Yeah, if so, I'll need to.
Yeah. But it'll all work out as long as you listen to the Lord. He'll snatch you up. He ain't got no problem snatching you up.
That's true.
Because, you know, he knows you want to make the right decision. So what do you think about your dream interpretation, Tom?
I really liked it. I thought it was pretty cool.
Pretty interesting, isn't it?
Very.
Was it helpful to you?
Very helpful.
Okay, alrighty. So you're going to do some of the things that I suggested?
Absolutely. Thank you.
All right. I'm your host, God's Girl. If anyone out there has a dream that they'd like to share or a dream that they'd like help interpreting, please feel free to send me a short email. My email address is godsgirltv@yahoo.com.
God's Girl will be right back after this short break.
Driving last Friday on her way to Cincinnati on a snow-white Christmas Eve. Going home to see her mama and her daddy with the baby in the back seat. 50 miles to go and she was running low on faith and gasoline. It'd been a long, hard year. She had a lot on her mind and she didn't pay attention. She was going way too fast. Before she knew it, she was spinning on a thin black sheet of glass. She saw both her lives flash before her eyes. She didn't even have time to cry. She was so scared. She threw her hands up in the air. Jesus, take the
Just wanted to take an opportunity to share with you that I just finished a teaching series on dream interpretation. So if you thought to yourself, I wonder how she does that. And you know what? I would like to help you learn how to interpret your dreams and dreams for others so we can bring glory to God and bring others to Christ and just be able to know what God is saying to our heart when we're asleep. So if you're interested in knowing what you can do to obtain your CD set, please send me an email at godsgirl@wrrw.fm. Once again, godsgirl@wrrw.fm. God bless you and thank you. Welcome to In Your Dreams, Chayla. How you doing today?
I'm doing good.
Good. Where are you calling from?
Calling from Chesapeake, Virginia.
Oh, okay. So you live in Chesapeake. That's great. So you had a dream. You sent me an email, and I thought it was rather cute. And I think that you thought it was cute, too, because you were laughing on the email.
Well, I was laughing because you said cute. I was like, well, okay.
Yeah. Yeah. So why don't you tell us a dream? It was about elephants, right?
Yeah. Okay. In the dream, I was running through a wheat field, and I tried to actually push a pig out of the way. Because it was in my way, and the pig was like green and blue, and I just kept pushing it, but it wouldn't budge. It was sitting there like it was eating or just, you know, occupied with something. And while I was trying to push it out of the way, I, you know, lifted my head up, and I noticed two like huge elephants coming toward me. It was far, far in the distance, but you know, the closer it got, you know, I noticed how big they were. So, you know, when I lifted in the dream, when I lifted my head up to look at them, the pig ran away because I guess the pig saw it too. He saw the elephants coming, so he took off.
Somebody had some common sense there, right?
Yeah. So the pig ran. I'm still standing there like, oh my goodness, there's big elephants coming my way. That was, the thing that got me was they were just so big.
Yeah.
Like one elephant was green, the other elephant was green and blue. So, like I said, they were just huge. That's what got me. I was like, oh my God, these things are so big. So that's why I ran away. I turned around and just kept running. And while I was running, I turned around and they were just getting closer and closer. Kept looking behind my back. And I'm like, oh my goodness, they're following me. They're following me. And then I woke up and that was it.
Okay.
It was short. It was very short.
Those are the kind we like.
Yeah.
I mean, I try not to turn anybody away if I can help them, but sometimes when they get into three scenes,
like
20 minutes later, it's like,
yeah, this one was pretty short, but it was very detailed.
Yeah, that sounds like a fun dream. But okay, so in the dream, now, have you ever really been in a wheat field in any time in your life? You know, did your parents own a farm, or was it a wheat field that you knew in real life?
Not at all.
Okay, all right. So what I want to do is I just want to make sure that these are symbols and they're not real life past experiences.
Okay,
so in this particular field, like you said, you knew it was a wheat field and there was a pig there. All right, so think about the dream just for a minute, but forget about the elephant and the pig.
Okay.
But in the dream, how did you feel? Or did you have any thoughts?
Not really. I mean, I wasn't like upset. I wasn't like, it was more so, I guess, more so, like, excited in the beginning. I was, I feel like I was on my way somewhere, and the pig was just in my way. And I was, I was trying to run, but he was just in my way, and I kept pushing him. But I wasn't, like, upset or scared or anything.
When you were pushing the pig, were you annoyed? Were you frustrated? Were you thinking?
Yeah, probably a little annoyed, because it was in my way.
Okay. All right. So, in real life...
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now it could be you go to church somewhere?
Yes.
All right. So in real life, you said you worked as a hairdresser too, right?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So whether it be at church, whether it be at work, whether it be in ministry, whether it be in your friendships or in family, is there somewhere in your life where you were excited that you were getting ready to go somewhere? Like you were moving forward in your life, but then something was in your way, and it was annoying.
Well, I'm excited about getting some bills paid and getting out of debt.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's good.
On my way to, just preparing, making, certain small things happen to get out of debt, like saving and cutting back and whatever I can to get out of debt, yeah.
Okay. So... let's just say this is talking about your financial situation.
Okay.
Now, a field of wheat,
mm-hmm.
What does that mean to you?
A field of wheat?
Mm-hmm.
Something growing or...
Well, we have work fields, right?
Okay.
Like you work in the field of cosmetology.
Mm-hmm.
We have ministry fields, like field of worship or field of evangelistic calling. But then we have a wheat field in your dream.
Okay.
And so if it has to do with your financial situation, what specifically is wheat?
Prosperous, harvest.
Yeah. Or it's also bread, too, isn't it?
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, bread.
Okay, I didn't think of that.
And so what do we call money?
Bread.
Yeah. girl, you learn.
Slang term for
black. You learn quick, girl. And these are just ideas that I'm throwing out. You know, just sometimes I can see things that you may not be able to see. Your answers are right because they're your answers, but you see it as prosperity, as harvest. Okay, so you're in this field of prosperity. You're in this field of harvest where there's a harvest there. You know, the wheat has come up, and you're in a field and you're surrounded by it, correct?
Mm-hmm.
All right, so if this is talking about the wheat being representative of money, which prosperity is usually what we call, I mean, we know there's more to prosperity than just money,
right?
But if it's symbolic for your financial situation, if we stick that symbol, you see how the wheat field would support that area of your life?
Yeah.
In the dream? Mm-hmm. So we got this pig, and something in the dream that's symbolic for the pig is in the way. And so pigs are also known as what? What's another name for a pig?
Hog?
Yeah. So something's hogging the field.
Okay.
There's this hog in the field, okay, of your prosperity field, your wealth field. And it's not getting out of the way, and it's a challenge for you. So what's hogging your prosperity?
Wow.
Thank you, Holy Spirit.
Wow.
Is there a person? Sometimes animals are symbolic for people. Is there a husband that's eating up your, you know, your income? Is there a mother-in-law that's needy? I mean, I'm just throwing ideas out. There's something that's in your way. It's specifically showing itself as a pig, as a hog.
Right. I can't think of anything that would be, like, in the way.
You're trying to get it out of your field.
Yeah, out of my field. Okay.
Out of your way. What has got to get out of your way that you're kind of wrestling with? You're trying to catch it. And it could be symbolic. I mean, when you think of a pig, what do you think of? Or hog?
A pig, I think of something that's dirty. I think of, you know, pig symbolic with fat.
Fat.
They eat anything.
Mm-hmm. I mean, some people in the Old Testament, you know, pigs were unclean.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they were something that we weren't supposed to eat. So it could be something that we're not supposed to touch. But you know how you people that eat a lot and
right.
You say, you know, you're a pig.
Yeah.
You know, so there's this animal that's devouring this unclean animal. That's devouring your field. What would you put that? I mean, if you had to pick something that's devouring your field of harvest or your field of prosperity in the financial, what would you say is eating up your wealth?
I have to really think about that because I do.
Well, this dream happened how long ago?
The dream?
About 2 weeks ago? Week ago?
Probably about 2 to 3 weeks ago.
Okay, well, was there a big bill that came? Was there a person that needed some money? Was there?
Well, actually, there was like a big bill that did come.
Okay.
I just looked at it like, wow, you know, I kind of felt like I was on a good track, and then here comes something else.
Okay, you know, that got in your way.
Yeah.
Okay, so what bill was that?
It's something like tax-wise.
Tax-wise.
Yeah.
Oh, and that would be so true because doesn't the government eat up and hog our money?
Yeah.
You know,
oh, wow.
They can hog a, is that clicking in your spirit?
Yeah.
I mean, it's like they hog a big chunk of it.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, it could be that maybe the pig isn't symbolic for a person, but just an entity that's hogging up your harvest, what you're trying to bring in into your household or what is yours, seemingly by right. So you got a big tax bill and that hogged a chunk of your money.
Wow. It's funny you said that because, now that I think about it, every time it seems like I'm, you know, making a good amount of money to pay certain things off or whatever, I feel like a big chunk of my money is going to that. It's like taken away.
And it's just in your way, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, and you're trying to get past that challenge and get that out of your field. But when you're while you're wrestling with that or while you're trying to catch that or trying to catch up with that because you were chasing after the pig, right?
Trying to push it out,
So when you're trying to push it out of the way, you're seeing these elephants from a distance.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so what does elephant mean to you?
An elephant is like, I think elephants are cute, but not everybody thinks elephants are cute, but I mean, that's just me.
Okay, so you like elephants.
I love animals, but, you know. elephant. When I think of an elephant, I think of just a really big, big animal. I can't think.
Yeah, yeah. All right, so, I mean, they're in the distance, and then as you, the pig starts running, and then mm-hmm. you start running from the elephants. And so the elephants, there's two of them specifically. Mm-hmm. Are there any people in your distance, like, you know, that are kind of far away, but these elephants, they get closer and closer. It seems no matter how fast you run, you can't mm-hmm. get away. So do you feel like in the dream you're being hounded? What would you say the thought was? My goodness, what?
In the dream, I was just like, my goodness, I'm running. I'm like, they're getting closer. They're just getting closer. The farther I run, the closer they're getting. That's what I was saying in the dream.
Okay, so in your financial situation, what off in the distance seems to be, you know, something that's right on your heels? It's big.
The tax bill.
Well, if we got the pig as the tax. If we got the pig as the tax, as the government. You know,
okay.
If that's that, then the elephants probably wouldn't be that.
Okay.
Unless, I don't know, one's green and one's blue. What does the color green mean to you?
Green to me, also like a, I guess, prosperous. Green, like a happy color.
Green's a happy color?
Yeah, I like green, so.
What about green and blue together? You said the pig was green and blue.
Yeah, one of the pig was green and blue striped, and then the elephant one was green, and then the other elephant one was green. It was green and blue, like together.
Okay, so we got the pig being green and blue, and we got the elephant being green and blue, which means that they could possibly be related. You know, because they're of the same skin color, right? Okay.
Right.
So there's a reason why the elephant's green and the other one's blue. And so what do you think of green and blue together? Like if I see red, white, and blue, to me that means America, you know, our colors, or it could mean the 4th of July. If I see blue and white together, I think of the Dallas Cowboys football team, you know. So when you think of green and blue together, does that mean anything to you?
Together, no, but blue to me is like a peaceful color or calm.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, blue is like a really calm color. Green, when I think of green, I just think of money or plants.
Plants?
Yeah, plants or flowers, like that. That's what I think of when I think of green.
Okay, like the earth, like the earth is green. So you think of like maybe nature?
Yeah, right, nature.
When you see green?
Mm-hmm.
Which would be? the natural world that we live in, having to pay taxes, mm-hmm. but you're running. So let me ask you in real life, if this has to do with your taxes, is there anything that you're running from? Are you running from any, maybe some bill collectors are calling you, and maybe it seems like no matter how far you try to run from them, they keep getting closer and closer.
Yeah.
Okay. So are there two big issues or two big maybe debts that you have? Green and blue could be symbolic for Wachovia Bank.
Well, I don't...
You know, those are their colors.
I don't have anything with Wachovia, but maybe...
But you see what I'm saying?
I see what you're saying,
I'm not saying
yeah.
that that's what it means, but
right,
Wachovia's
right.
colors are green and blue.
Okay.
And they could represent a financial institution if you knew that with your heart and your head, you know?
Right.
I only know because I used to bank with Wachovia, and they would give out green and blue lollipops.
Wow.
So, and you could see it just driving down the road and just, you know, make that assessment. It doesn't mean that there aren't other banks that don't have green and blue as their colors. But so you said that are there two big debts that were off in a distance at one point but now are getting closer and closer?
Yeah. There's a couple. There's actually a couple.
Which a couple is two.
Yeah, that's a couple. I guess the main thing was just my state taxes, and the other things are like, well, small bills like student loans, and
which isn't really small.
Well, yeah.
Student loans are.
Yeah.
I know some people that owe $20,000 for student loans.
Oh wow!
But see, the student loan is connected to the government.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? Because it's a government loan. You got the pig being like, you know, symbolic of a government institution with the taxes, and you've got two bigger debts that are off in the far distance, but no matter how far you try to run, you can't get away. And it's not, doesn't necessarily mean that you're running, meaning you don't want to deal with it. It just could mean that those are so big that those are really the last thing you want to try to tackle. Because people will teach you in financial classes to start with the smallest bill first, pay that off, and then your list is getting smaller and smaller and smaller, and then tackle the bigger bills. Have you heard that before?
Yeah, I have heard that before.
Okay. So you could be, you know, doing good in real life, trying to tackle the smaller stuff. And, I mean, if we don't have the money, when people call, we avoid them, whether we don't answer the phone or whether we tell them, and they don't want to hear your answer. They just want to know, when can you pay them?
Right.
And basically, like a herd of elephants, you know, they can sound like they're getting ready to stampede you, or like they're hounding you. You know, the dream could have had hound dogs chasing you.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
Okay.
So is that too far of a stretch, or do you see how that could possibly fit in your life?
I do see that, and it just made me think of something. I thought of a bill collector that called me recently for payment, and, you know, I told them that I can pay them a certain amount each month, which was really a small amount. And the guy on the other end was just like, you know, this is nothing. You know, you're going to have to pay a little bit more than that, or we're going to go into your account.
Mm-hmm.
And I told them, you know, I don't have it. I have to give you what I can now until I can afford to pay the bigger amount that they want me to.
Mm-hmm. It's never good enough, is it?
Yeah.
And I understand that they have a right to their money. And you know what? All embarrassment aside, because I'll be honest, I've had IRS come after me and they levied my account about 2 years ago. Mm-hmm. And so I know what it feels like to get all of your money taken without being able to do anything about it.
Right.
But all we can do is just turn it over to Jesus and ask him to help us to do the best that we can, and really know in our hearts that we're being good stewards over what God has given us. And I think the fact that you're trying is great, you know. So you just might want to, the dream shows that you're running from them. And so if you're running in real life, you may want to try to just address it.
Right.
And just say, you know what, you know, if it's IRS, you really can't do anything. But if it's like a bill collector, they're not allowed to harass you and keep calling you and calling you and calling you. You know, sometimes bankruptcy is an option, not for the IRS. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I think God honors us when we try to pay. And I think it's ideal that we try to pay. But we have to remember then God's word that he provided Jubilee for the Israelites. And it was so people wouldn't be in bondage to one another. And bankruptcy is just really, in my opinion, God's American form of Jubilee. And it's not something that we should take advantage of, but it's not something we should be embarrassed of either if we have to go that way. Donald Trump filed bankruptcy, from what I understand, 3 different times, you know, and now he's living, you know, the American real estate dream. And not that I want to be, you know, like him or like that, but it's his dream. So, you know, in the dream, you're running from the elephants and they're in your field, and I'm sure they're trampling that field.
Mm-hmm.
So I would just say, okay, Lord, help me to deal with the elephants. And I'll just leave you with this short story. Mm-hmm. I have a girlfriend who's a prophet, and she owed some money, and it was with the state. I think it was real estate tax. And the lady working in the office just happened to be a Christian, but my friend didn't know that when she wrote the letter. Mm-hmm. But she wrote the letter, and she said she didn't have the money. She said, but I'm pleading if you could just find a way to have mercy on me. And she said that the Lord told her to put that in the letter. And the lady called her and said, I'm a Christian. She goes, and I can have mercy on you. And she extended her date a whole year to be able to pay. I think it was like $15,000.
Wow.
So, you know, all things are possible with God. That was a rhema word for her. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying that God's saying that to you, but to pray and ask him, Lord, you know, how can I deal with this and face those elephants, you know?
Right.
And take dominion over my field of harvest, the field of prosperity that you have me in, and be able to, you know, take this challenge head on in the spirit of the Lord, with the fear and the admiration that Jesus has given us to maintain and to have dominion. So that's what you want to do. You want to stop running from the elephants and you want to face it. Now, after you face it, if they keep pounding you, at least you know that you tried. You know what I mean?
Right.
And you're just at a stalemate. So what do you think about your dream interpretation?
It makes sense. It makes a whole lot of sense now.
Well, that's good. That's all we want to do is just throw out some ideas and find out what part of your life it's talking about, and then just address it with God's word.
Right.
And pray for change.
Okay.
So, well, thank you for calling In Your Dreams. All right, I'm your host, God's Girl. If anybody out there has a dream that they'd like help interpreting or a short dream that they'd like to share, please feel free to send me your dream on email. My email address is godsgirltv@yahoo.com. godsgirltv@yahoo.com. Thank you so much for listening. I'm your host, God's Girl, and I just want to take the time to just remind you, if you're already saved, that's great, that Jesus is Lord. And if you're not saved, you know what? Jesus can be your Lord. All you have to do to be part of God's family is just believe the truth that Jesus died on the cross for all of the world's sin. He shed his blood so that we could have eternal life and live with him forever and be forgiven of being born into this sinful world. So if that sounds really good to you and you're interested in being a part of God's family, all you have to do is just say, Lord, you know what? I never really thought about it too much, but I've heard this truth, and I want to be forgiven, and I want to accept your free gift of salvation. Lord, please come into my heart, make me a new person, and give me eternal life with you. Thank you for forgiving me of my sins, and I appreciate this free gift. That's all it takes, and you're part of the family of God. Now walk holy, walk upright, live right, try to please him for the rest of your life, and just see if your world is not rocked. God bless you, and welcome to the family. Hey everyone, just wanted to take an opportunity to share with you that I just finished a teaching series on dream interpretation. So if you thought to yourself, I wonder how she does that. Well, you know what? I would like to help you learn how to interpret your dreams and dreams for others so we can bring glory to God and bring others to Christ and just be able to know what God is saying to our heart when we're asleep. So if you're interested in knowing what you can do to obtain your CD set, please send me an email at godsgirl@wrrw.fm. Once again, godsgirl@wrrw.fm. God bless you and thank you. FYI, everyone. Hey, got some news for you. I get email requests asking about dream books and which ones are good. So if you're interested in checking out the dream book referrals that I have, go check it out on MySpace. Go to www.myspace.com/godsgirltv. Once again, my MySpace webpage is www.myspace.com/godsgirltv, as in television. When you get time, feel free to check it out. I've got book titles on there, authors' names, and their web links. And hey, do these Christian guys a favor. Cut out the middleman and buy it straight from their webpage. And I'm sure they'll appreciate that very much. God bless you, and thanks for checking out MySpace.